And welcome to Witness with Paul McDermott. Tonight we ask Rupert Murdoch the tough questions. Who does your hair? Would you like red or white wine? And are you the same Rupert who signed my paycheck? My favorite story of the past few weeks was the police raid on the Adelaide home of Fat Cat, where 30 cannabis plants were allegedly found. The former children's TV star denied any wrongdoing, saying he didn't need to use drugs at all because every time he looked in the mirror, he saw a giant orange cat. But he wasn't the only celebrity investigated. Other celebrities included the Magic Mirror, who was examined for traces of cocaine, Humphrey B. Bear, who refused to talk, and the entire cast of Sesame Street were arrested after police noticed that today's letter has been the letter E for the past 4 weeks. Now, another star in the news is Dougie the delivery boy from the Pizza Hut ads, who was involved in a very serious car accident. He's facing a charge of driving without a license, but if not convicted within 30 minutes, he's free. I hope you all had a wonderful Easter. It's always a very special time in our house. My father is a very, very keen hider of the old Easter eggs. He'd seal them in concrete, behind brick walls, under the floorboards. The Yorkshire House of Horrors had nothing on my dad. He's the Fred West of hiding the old Easter eggs. When the police finally raided our place, they found 14 eggs in various stages of decomposition in the backyard. But my father just laughed and laughed because he knew there were 10 more eggs buried in the local park they'd never ever find. Thank you. Good evening and welcome to Good News Week. What part is good, what part is news, and what part is weak will become very obvious as the show progresses. Joining me tonight, well, when your parents told you not to talk to strangers, he was the stranger they were talking about. And there's none stranger than the man himself, radio star, sex god, and leader of our first team, Mr. Mikey Robbins. And with Mikey, the siren who makes men and some women pull over faster than a fire engine, Kate Fischer. And the stand-up comedian who believes all Frank Spencer impersonators should be brutally murdered, James O'Loughlin. And leading our second team is a man who knows a bargain when he sees one. And didn't he see one or two at Liberace's garage sale? All hail the king of polyester, Mr. Anthony Ackroyd. Joining Anthony is a star of Frontline who knows that inside every current affairs presenter is a game show host just dying to get out. Alison Whyte. And a comedienne, not to be confused with a geographical feature, Sandy Island. So having got the awkward introductions out of the way, let's get into the awkward questions. Round one, in which we test just how much our teams know about the latest news. Mikey, Kate, and James, have a look at this and tell us the whole story.
Kenneth Brenner. yes.
I think someone assassinated our new Prime Minister.
No, that's, of course, it's Unabomber.
Is that the guy with the broken nose?
Yes, it is the man with the broken nose.
Did Unabomber break his nose 3 times so he wouldn't be recognised?
Well, he got off lightly.
It's the Unabomber. They caught him in his hut, and it's good for a bomber to have a hut, because that's where, Well, thank you. Can I say hut again?
For someone smart enough to build all those bombs, you think he could have figured out a cleverer disguise.
Yeah. I'll I'll just put the Parker on. That'll get him.
Hit myself in the nose with a hammer, friend.
You're quite right, of course. It was the Unabomber, 53-year-old Theodore Kaczynski, allegedly responsible for 3 deaths and more than 20 injuries. He was arrested by the FBI last week after a manhunt that lasted 18 years. Theodore's family is also relieved that he's been caught, finally ending the terrifying Christmas ritual of opening the presents. Anthony, Alison and Sandy, these moving pictures are for you.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes. Oh, go for it.
It's the family.
Oh, yes. Oh, I can say that again. I remember it well. Yeah, Adelaide Mardi Gras, right? Woo! Now, that is, of course, the LAPD. They get a bit excited, don't they, sometimes? When they pull you over, they check your license, they get carried away, and they just beat the crap out of you. Particularly if you could be a Mexican.
Oh, that's exactly correct. 5 years after the infamous Rodney King bashing, LA police have again been videotaped, viciously beating members of a minority group. The deputies were asked why they'd been so brutal when the suspects weren't even black. One... One officer allegedly replied, well, they are now. Just wait for it before you make your decisions. Anyway, with both teams on a truly awesome 2 points, we move on to Strange But True, the round devoted to the news from the darker side of life. Each team is given 3 clues to a recent, weird and wonderful story. Later in the show, they have to tell us the tale. Mikey, Kate and James, your clues are...
Yes.
A cask of wine.
That's for Mikey.
That's a good start.
Okay.
It's empty.
2 earplugs. And... 2 tampons. Yes, and Kate got there before anyone else.
Apart from down, I'm just thinking, is it maybe a Margaret Fulton recipe that went horribly wrong?
We turn to Anthony, Alison and Sandy.
What you got for us?
Your clues are... crowbar.
Oh, yeah.
Very nice.
Uh-huh. Oh, nice.
A cute and cuddly teddy bear.
Oh.
And last but not least, a VCR.
Oh.
Oh, it's so obvious.
Now, in round 2, team members go 1-on-1, pitting their finely honed skills against their opposite number. Team leaders, your game is bites. Mikey, what is the former Governor General Bill Hayden talking about here?
Oh, right. Mm-hmm.
There are a few revelatory things that he wanted to demonstrate to me to show that I was wrong. I'm looking forward to this with keen anticipation.
He's obviously referring there to his ex-mate, Bob Hawke. I say ex because in his new book, Bill, Lust for Glory, Bill actually pointed out that Bob's hung like a duck. The ex-PM ain't packing much meat. You can't make butter with a toothpick, Paul.
You're right, Mikey. After being less than expansive about Bob Hawke's local member in his autobiography, Hayden says Hawkey is anxious to give a demonstration of the penis he refers to as Kosciuszko.
Is that because everyone's been up?
It's actually snow-capped as well. Leave it in, cover.
As Bob would say. Anyway. And I thought Bill would have known what it was like because Bob gave him a demonstration back in 1983 when he became the Labour leader and screwed him to the wall. Anthony, a delicious bite of John Major now for you.
Oh, yum.
It's not only dropped in the United Kingdom, it has dropped quite dramatically in many other European countries. So we all have a common interest in dealing with this problem of confidence.
Oh, yeah. He's talking about my penis. I'm going to answer this question in mime to demonstrate my longitudinous skills.
Yes, consumption of British beef has mysteriously dropped off due to what John calls a problem of confidence. I suppose confidence in whether the next hamburger you have is going to rot away your brain and cause you to die in agony. And frankly, I'd call that a bit of a problem. Mad cow disease or bovine spongiform encephalopathy destroys all motor skills. Doctors believe it may have started in the English cricket team. The second contest in round two is tabloid roulette. Now, we show you three headlines from some trashy magazines. Two are fake, one is real. All you have to do is pick the real headline. For you, Kate, shocking John Travolta, too fat to act. And two, Oprah agrees to on-camera stomach staple. Three, horror as Roseanne's facelift explodes.
Yeah, no, definitely.
Oh, yeah.
Do you think she would have done that? She's lost her way.
She's done everything.
Maybe it's that.
No, he's fat. They're both dead. Two's false!
Oh. Okay, two's false.
Yes, Great. We are actually looking for the real one.
Shocking John Travolta, too fat to act, is real.
Yes! Yes! Shocking John Travolta, too fat to act. Here's the story. Look who's porky now. With some very unflattering photographs taken on the set of John's latest action blockbuster, Broken Zipper, it seems his decision to hire Marlon Brando as a personal trainer would now appear to be a mistake. John says he realized he was getting a bit wide when an LA street gang drove by and covered him in graffiti. Now, Alison, you ready for this one?
Yeah.
Okay, villagers terrified of blood-sucking leech man. Heartwarming bravery of the wolf girl. And last but certainly not least, first pictures of Moroa Pigeon Boy. Which is the true headline?
Oh, God.
Tick, 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 tick.
Hey.
Teddy knows the answer.
Teddy Tell?
Oh, take as long as you want. Everyone else does.
So one of these is true.
Heartwarming bravery of the wolf girl.
Sounds
good. And you're right. Yeah. Heartwarming bravery of the wolf girl is right. I tried to stop Darren Hinch having children. I really did. The last game in one-on-one is missing persons. James, which well-known face have we removed from this photograph?
That'd be his wife. If it's not Bill Hayden, because they don't get on very well anymore, it would be... it'd be Alexander Downer, because I haven't met yet.
Beautiful, eloquent, and true. Yes, it is Australia's newest Minister for Foreign Affairs, Alexander Downer.
Fills you with confidence, doesn't it?
This photograph was actually taken as Alexander was receiving the traditional Malaysian greeting of a full cavity search. Sandy, who is the missing person sitting beside this transvestite in a Chicago bar?
Dad?
No. He doesn't travel.
Oh, that's a good word, the hand. Yep.
We're going with...
So you're happy with that?
Okay, well, then. Malcolm Fraser.
Exactly. Yes, let's hear it. It's the ex-Prime Minister and eminent person, Malcolm Fraser. Sadly, this wouldn't be the last time a man pretending to be a woman fooled the Liberals. Whatever did happen to Bronwyn Bishop? Now, checking the scores, Mikey, Kate and James are looking very, very conservative on 4 points. While Anthony, Alison and Sandy are wandering around with their trousers just about down on a very similar 4 points. We've arrived at breakneck speed at the beautiful round three, odd one out. Can you guess what you have to do here? Mikey, Kate and James, who doesn't belong here?
Mikey.
Oh.
Richard Nixon there?
Yep.
Adolf Hitler?
Yep.
Attila the Hun? And Adolf Hitler again. No, it's Jeff Kennedy.
See, well, Attila the Hun's the only one in profile.
I think this is an invasion question, actually. Huh? It's a military question. Nixon secretly bombed Cambodia.
Hitler's got a moustache.
An invasion of his face.
It's actually nostril hair that's invaded the face.
Jeff's the only one that's had anything to do with the motorcycle Grand Prix.
Jeff's the only one... Jeff's the only one with a hat. Yeah. Jeff.
Well, Hitler wore one a bit.
And Nixon owned one.
What's the final decision?
Jeff.
There?
Jeff. He's the only one in colour.
Yeah, he's the only one alive.
All those are very, very good reasons for choosing Jeff. However, you're all wrong. It is, in fact, Attila the Hun.
Profile.
Because he's a drawing.
I wish I was a drawing.
Attila the Hun because he's the only one who believed that military training should be voluntary. Anthony, Allison and Sandy?
Yep.
Can you spot the unwelcome visitors here? The Bridges brothers?
Oh, yeah.
Bo and Jeff? The Marx brothers?
Uh-huh.
The Dado brothers?
Oh.
The Menendez brothers?
Well, that's pretty obvious. The Dado brothers are androids.
No, that's just one of them, Android Dado.
Menendez brothers do funniest home video.
Yeah.
And it's
not at home with mum and dad.
It's not on general release or anything, but it's. No, well, the Menendez brothers, I think, I'll have to consult with my teammates, are the only people who have killed their parents.
Yeah.
Are you happy with that?
Yeah, Menendez brothers.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going with the Menendez brothers.
I'm going very strong.
Of course, it's the Dado brothers. The others got where they are today on their acting ability alone. So close and yet so backward. After the guilty verdict, Lyle and Eric Menendez released a statement expressing deep regret. They say they're very, very sorry they aren't famous black American football players. Scores at the business end of the show, and the Robbins family is happily dysfunctional on a very proud, still 4 points. While the Ackroyd bunch is playing happily and staying together on the same 4 points. It's good news week. Now back to Strange But True. Earlier on, we gave Mikey, Kate and James some wine, some earplugs, and two tampons. Mikey, would it's, you start to tell the strange tale?
It's a night out with Prince Edward. No. Sadly, it's actually a rather sad true story of a woman and a man who loved each other very much, but the man snored atrociously. So to stop his snoring, she actually got him stonkered on the claret and sleeping pills, and then put the earplugs in her ear. And when that didn't work, she shoved two tampons up his nose. And because the earplugs were in her ear, I believe she didn't hear him cark it during the night.
But you see, these are super tampons, and had she used light flow day tampons, he wouldn't have died.
You are right. It is the story of Mark Gleason from Surrey in England. He was told by doctors that his snoring was incurable. Undaunted, Mark and his girlfriend Tracy decided to solve the problem themselves. He drank a few glasses of wine, dropped a couple of sleeping pills, then shoved two tampons up his nose. Tracy left him sleeping very peacefully on the couch and found him dead there the next morning, her Libre-Fleur still wedged up his nasal passage. Tracy says it's such a tragedy that Mark is dead because he really wanted to lead an active social life. But imagine if their anti-snoring experiment had been a success. It would have changed man's relationship with tampons forever. Pretty soon, men wouldn't go anywhere without them. I mean, what if you fell asleep at a party, started snoring, and didn't have any tampons? You'd have to run home with a cardigan tied around your head. And our second proud team were given earlier on in the evening a crowbar, a VCR, and a teddy bear.
Oh, yeah.
Anthony, Alison, and Sandy.
Oh, yeah.
What's the story?
Sure, the opposing team gave the correct answer. But was it entertaining enough and using the whole team? I think not, Paul.
Thanks.
Let's set the scene, Paul, and audience. It's the middle of the night, the dead of night, not a mouse stirred. Maybe a couple of scorpions, I don't know, Paul. Felons are breaking into a house. Entertainment, Paul, entertainment.
Oh, sorry.
You upstaging bastard! Okay.
I just wanted to make a little pillow before you went on.
We're all pretty familiar with that sight, Mikey. Then, a toddler is stirred by the sounds. She says to herself...
Can I help you?
The felons react by saying, hey, let's think quick.
Can I help you?
The child makes an offer.
Enough of that in the press lately. No need it here.
That rings a bell. Anyway, and then proceeds to show the villains around the house, showing them where all the goods are. The felons leave happily, dancing a jig down the street.
Very nice.
The parents wake up in the morning and they think, that kid is never going to get another Christmas present. It's all that. That's what happened, Paul.
Wow.
I think I really built that to the crest of a slump there.
I think we all did.
I think Plan School's the next the next
it.
Show for you fellas. That was extraordinary.
Now, boys and girls, here's a mad cow.
Eat the teddy.
It wasn't a girl at all. It was actually 4-year-old Russell Brown, who was a lad. He heard a noise in the middle of the night and went downstairs to investigate, where he found two nice people who said they were just borrowing a few things. They were very, very friendly, so when they asked where the VCR and the stereo and Mummy's purse were, young Russell was only too happy to show them. He even held the back door open for them while they carried the loot to the car.
Yay.
Then, having said nine-nines to his new chums, Russell tiptoed back to Sleepy Bobo's, being very careful not to wake Mummy and Daddy. After interviewing Russell, Police are now searching for a Mr. Sandman and someone who calls himself the Tooth Fairy. Okay, so after the big fight behind the bike sheds, we find the teams level pegging on a big 6 points apiece. So to prove there is one last bastion of democracy in this country, we're going to throw it open to the audience. Please, with a round of applause, cheers and jeers, if you think Mikey's team should win, let's hear it. Unfair! Okay, let's hear it for Anthony's team.
Yeah!
I think I'm going to have to award it to Anthony's team for the sheer bravery of showing that lily-livered chest on television. So we say now good night to the losers, Mikey Robbins, Kate Fisher, and James O'Loughlin. Good night to the victors with the rather tragic nipples, Anthony Ackroyd, Alison Whyte, and Sandy Island. And we leave you now with the good news that Fat Cat and his partner, Patsy Bisco, have silenced all drug-related allegations by giving this statement to the police. Good night.
It's good news we know. Someone's dropped the bomb, so we're contaminating.
If you'd like to be in the audience for Good News Week, please call 9950-3037 on Monday after 9 a.m. That's 9950-3037.